Hello, my name is Fritz de Mul, and this is a presentation about my topics in magnetism taken from my course on electromagnetism. This is part one of the presentation. Here are the available presentations about electricity, magnetism and electromagnetic waves that can be downloaded from this site. And this is the contents of this presentation about magnetic topics. Part A contains topic number 1 through 13, part B, part 2, 14 to 27, and this is part 1. The magnetic force on a current wire. Suppose we have a flow tube with moving charges, total current I, cross-section S is variable, and there is an external field B. We can define volume elements with a length dl and a cross-section area ds and a propagation direction et. The current density J is given by the amperes, number of amperes per square meter, and J can be expressed in as nqv, in which n is the number of particles per cubic meter, q is its charge, and V is its velocity. The Lorentz force on one charge is given by charge times velocity times the external field, and we have a vector multiplication here. Per unit of volume, since we have n particles per cubic meter, it will be nqv times b, or that can be written as j times b, factorial product. This is per unit of volume, so for the volume dv we have to multiply with dv, or that's ds dl. And when we take j and ds together here, then we can write the vector j as the modulus of j times et, and then we have this expression here with et times b. And since we can take et and dl together in a vector dl, we have the well-known expression for the Lorentz force on a volume element, a line element of a current line. Suppose we have a straight conductor in a homogeneous field, then the force has to be integrated over the line, and that leads to the well-known relation of the Lorentz force on a current line as the product of the current, the length, and the magnetic field, and the direction is given by this factorial product. And it is seen that F is perpendicular to ET and to B, and thus in this case F will be pointing perpendicular to the plane of drawing. The Hall effect. Suppose we have n charge carriers per cubic meter in a block of material here. There is a current I through the block and an external magnetic field. And that B field will cause a deviation of the path of the charge carriers. In this way. And that is caused by the Lorentz force. There will be a built-up of an electric field, the Hall field, between Q and P, in which Q will be positive and P will become negative. In the stationary case, the built-up will go on until the magnetic force and the electric force balance each other, and in that case the QVB will be equal to QE Hall. When we write J as nqv or equal to I over the cross-section area AD, then we get for the Hall field V times B this expression here proportional to I and B. And thus the Hall potential is the potential difference between Q and P, that is E Hall times D, and that is given by I times B over NQA. And this means that we have created a magnetometer, because the Hall potential Vp minus Vq is proportional to the external field. Now the magnetic field of a line current. Bio and Savar again. Here is Et, that's the direction of propagation of the current. Er is the direction of the distance to the point of observation, and r, small r, is the distance to the point of observation. The question is, determine B and P. The approach. We take current line elements dl. We can write those as a vector by including Et, or dl for the length. And when we calculate the factorial product here, we'll see that Et times Er is always in the direction of phi, tangential, because Et and Er are always in this plane. And so Ephi has to be perpendicular to that plane. We introduce an angle theta. And then we can write for Et times Er, the sine of theta. And for dl, we can write dz. dl is dz. For the integration, we take as the variable, integration variable z. Then we have to write small r as a function of z and the sine of theta as a function of z. That has been done here. And you have to integrate from minus infinity to plus infinity. Or you can take theta as the variable, then you have to write 1 over small r squared in the, as a function of theta. Sine theta is okay, and then you have to write dz as a function of d theta. And that can be done using z over r as a function of theta. And you can differentiate it. And the result is that the b in p is mu naught I over 2 pi times the distance times the tangential vector. And it is seen that b will be proportional to 1 over the distance, and this means that here we have cylindrical symmetry. A circular circuit. That's seen here. Current I, radius R, Bio and Savar again, and the question is determine B in point P. We have current line elements again, with factor dl, and there is a direction vector to point P, Er. And now we see that the vector product Et times Er, in which Et is along dl, dl is dl, Et, is always 1, because dl and Er are always perpendicular. And so there will be symmetry, and the only component remaining is the y component. And thus we have to calculate dBy, as is seen here, dBy. Suppose there is an angle alpha here, and then we can write 1 over r squared dl cosine alpha. But the alpha is constant, is the same for the whole circumference of the circuit. And 1 over r squared is equal, the same for all points on the circle. And so we can take 1 over r squared outside the integral. We can do the integral, this 2 pi r is just the circumference of the circle, and this is the cosine. And we end up with this expression, mu naught I r squared over 2 times rp squared plus r squared to the power 3 over 2. And this result we can use for the magnetic field of a circular solenoid. That's here with a radius r, current I, and there are n coils and small n coils per meter. And we want to know the field in point P on the axis. The approach is, consider the solenoid as a set of circular circuits, and for each circuit we have Bp is mu naught I r squared over 2 times Rp squared plus r squared to the power 3 over 2. And the direction is along the axis. And Rp here is the distance from the circuit to P, as is seen here. Now, to perform the integration, consider each circuit as a strip with a width dy and a current dy and the current dI, and the current dI is n dy times I. And when we insert that in the equation for B, we end up with this expression. We have to write Rp as a function of y. This is done here. And then we end up with a result for the length going to infinity is mu naught ni over ey. And you can see that it is independent of the radius and the length. Point 6, magnetic forces between currents. Here we have the two currents, I1 and I2, at a distance 1R12, and the question is determine the Lorentz force exerted by one on two. We have the relations here, B and the Lorentz force, and here are the vectors, the tangential vector and the position vector, here in tangential vector. And here we have E theta 1, and we will see, consider this in a minute. The calculation. B, felt by 2, exerted by 1, felt by 2 at the position of current 2, is mu naught I1 over 2 pi R12 times the tangential vector E theta 1. Now, current I2 feels an external field, B12, and thus will undergo a Lorentz force F from 1 on 2, and that's given here. Well, now, E T2 times E theta 1, factorial product, is minus E R 1. Minus E R 1. So the Lorentz force here, F from 1 on 2, is directed towards current 1, as we is expressed in this relation here. And thus, if L1 is L2, then the force from 1 on 2 will be the same as the force from 2 on 1, except for the minus sign. And thus, if the currents have the same direction, the force will be attractive. But the question remains, why is the wire moved by a Lorentz force? Since inside the wire we have only the conduction electrons that can move, but the metal ions are fixed. Here we have a fixed ion lattice and conduction electrons. There is a magnetic field perpendicular to the plane of driving, as is seen here. And it means that the electrons will feel a Lorentz force, And it means that there will be a concentration of electrons at one side of the conductor. That's in fact is the Hall effect, of course. The lattice ions feel a force upwards, and therefore the ions will move upwards, and this force on the metal ions is electric, and that's the reason that the wire can move. Point 8, Ampere's law. We have a long, thin, straight wire with a current I, and the question is, determine the circulation of the B field along circle L. We have Biot-Machin-Vair, seen before, mu naught I over 2 pi r, the cylindrical symmetry. And when we calculate it for this current circuit, we have the expression for the B here, times the direction vector, E theta, times the dl, and dl is E theta dl. So we have here an scalar product of E theta times E theta, and of course this is 1. And the integration over the circuit is simply 2 pi r. And so we end up with the circuit integral of BdL is just mu naught times the current, and that is Ampere's law. Ampere's law. Now we relax the shape of the circuit a little bit, as is seen here, circuit C, and the question is determine the circulation of the B field along that circuit. Now, here is the L in a certain point, and what we need is the projection of the L on B, here in this scalar product. Projection of BdL. And you can see that this the projection is this distance, and this distance is also given by r d theta here when we consider the underlying circle here. R d theta along the circle. And when we integrate r d theta over the whole circle, we end up with r times 2 pi. And so, again, the circulation of BdL is mu naught I, although the curve has an odd shape. The consequences are, when you have more circuits through C, it will add up in the circulation, not in the B field itself, but in the circulation of the B field. Currents outside C do not contribute, and the position of the current inside C is not important. The B field from a thick wire. We have a cylinder with radius r, here is the Ampere's law, in which the current is written as the surface integral of the current density in amperes per square meter times the number of square meters. There are two options for the current. One at the surface, and two, the current is distributed homogeneously in the volume. We use Ampere circuits with a radius r, and there are some possibilities. When r is larger than the radius, then the enclosed current is simply I, the circumference, the integral, gives 2 pi r, and thus the field is mu naught I over 2 pi r. However, when r is smaller than capital R, the radius, then there are two possibilities. First, when the current is at the surface, then inside the field is zero, here, but when we have a homogeneously distributed current density, then the circulation is given by the portion of the current that is inside the circle, and that's pi r squared over pi capital R squared. And so the B is given by this formula here, and that is a linear relation. And so when we make a graph, then for option 1, we start with 0 until we reach the outer circle, outer radius of the cylinder, and then it goes with 1 over r. Option 2 starts linearly and it also goes with 1 over r outside. The magnetic induction of a solenoid. Here is the solenoid with radius r and current I, and suppose that the length is much larger than r and there are n coils per meter. The B field will have three components, z, r and phi component, as is seen here. First, we start with the R component, and therefore we take a Gauss box, inside or outside. The flux, total flux, will be zero, because the flux is pointing inward and outward, and this means that the top and the bottom flux will be equal, because, of course, due to symmetry. And so the flux through the wall will be zero, and thus the radial component of the B will be zero. That's number one. Now, for the second component, the phi component, we choose a circuit. The circuit has a radius r. And for ampere, it holds that B phi is 2 pi r is 0, because there is no current pointing through that circuit. Well, of course, there is only one of the coils, but due to the large number of coils, this contribution can be neglected. So the phi component will be zero, negligible. Then the third component, BZ. Therefore we choose two circuits at distances A and B from the midline. The circuit 2 has no current inside, so the B is zero outside the solenoid, and inside the solenoid we have the circulation around the rectangle gives a contribution from the left side, and the other three sides have no contribution. So ampere gives us BZ times L is mu naught, and I, that is the enclosed current, times L. And the result is inside B is mu naught and I, and outside B is zero. Altogether, we have the following symmetries for Ampere's law. And here is Ampere's law again. The circulation of B over the circuit is mu naught times the current density integrated over the surface, enclosed by that circuit. Here we have the symmetry for the wire, for the solenoid, for a plane with a similar rectangle as the solenoid, because a solenoid can be considered, a long and large solenoid can be considered as consisting of planes, and a toroid along the core line. Magnetic pressure. The question is, why does a solenoid try to maximize its current section, its cross section? Why does it try to enclose the maximum fitting flux? Here is a layer of a small part of the solenoid, plane layer. We consider a plane layer with current density J, J in amperes per meter, here. And the plane layer has current density J. Now the B field of the layer, that is circuit L, will give us 2BL, that this side here and this side here. And this side and the side above will not contribute. And so we end up with 2BL times L, the length is mu naught JL the current and closed current, and BL is plus or minus half mu naught J times EZ, the direction. Upwards on the right side, downwards on the back side. Suppose now we add an external field so that the total field behind the layer is zero, as is seen here. And on the front side, the two fields will add up. The Lorentz force on this field here will be I times L times ET times BE. This is the external field. And so the Lorentz force is the I is J times dB, the L is dL for the element, and the BE is half mu naught times J, and the direction is in the Z direction. And so we have half mu naught J squared times dB dL. Now, dB dL is the area of this rectangle. And thus, when we divide the force by that area, then we end up with the pressure, is half mu naught J squared. And it can also be written as a half external field squared over mu naught. And that situation at the wall of a cylinder implies that there is a pressure outward, and therefore the solenoid tries to maximize the cross-section area. Now we go to something completely different, the vector potential. We know the electric scalar potential, the E as minus the gradient of the potential function. And now we define a vector potential, magnetic vector potential, as the circulation, the rotation or the curl of A is equal to the magnetic induction. Vector potential is A. We know that for the electric case we have this expression for the gradient, and for the magnetic case we have this expression for the rotation or the curl. And B, the result will be a vector. The vector is perpendicular to A. However, please realize that with this definition only the spatial derivatives are defined. Only when you know the B, you can calculate the A, but you can calculate only the dA dx, dA dy and dA dz, but not AX, EY and EZ itself. The absolute values can be determined by integration, but there is always a constant that can be added to the outcome. And therefore, only differences of the potential between two points have a physical meaning. Potential differences. And you would like to consider one of the points as the reference point. For instance, with the electric potential of a charge of a sphere or something like that, then you can consider the point in infinity as the reference point, or the point in zero as the reference point, what you like. The definition was given by B is the rotation of A, and here we have a flow tube with a volume V prime and volume elements dV prime with a current density J, and we want to calculate the vector potential in P from the Biot-Savart law for the B, the induction, and it is important to realize that the distance from P to the volume element is a function of six coordinates, the external coordinates x, y, z, and the internal coordinates x prime, y prime, z prime. This is Bio and Sapphire. Now, ER over R squared can be written as the gradient of 1 over R in cylinder coordinates with a minus. Minus the gradient of 1 over R. And now, here we have two vectors. We can interchange the vectors, the gradient of 1 over r times j, but then there is an extra minus sign, and that will cancel this minus sign here. And now, here we have a term, and here we have a term, and this looks very much like the chain rule. UdV is duv minus vdu. And here, the j is the u, and the 1 over r the is the v. And so we can write the rotation of j over r, that's this term here, minus the rotation of j over r, that's this term here, dv, dv prime, integrated over the volume. But now, the rotation is a function of the external coordinates, but the j is a function of the internal coordinates, and so the rotation of j will be zero. And thus, the b can be written as mu naught over 4 pi times the volume integral of the rotation of j over r, and the second term here cancels. Now we swap the differentiation as a function of x, y, z, and the integration, the function of the internal coordinates. And then we have that the b is the rotation of this expression here, and taking into account the definition above, we see that the a is given by the expression of mu naught over 4 pi times the volume integral of the current density over the distance, 2p, times the volume element. Here is the general equation again, and when we have a circuit, then the j can be taken outside the integral in the form of the I, and that can be done here as well. And then we have to, for a circuit, we have not volume integration, but a line integration with dl. Some helpful relations here are the circulation of the A over the circuit, that is as in the normal vector relation of the rotation integral over the surface, the area enclosed by that circuit, and this will be BdS, and that's the flux. The circuit C here encloses the area S, and this is just a Stokes relation. There is another one. The rotation of B is the rotation of the rotation of A, and this can be written for all vectors, for any vector, as the gradient of the divergence of A minus the Laplacian of A. And since the divergence of A is zero, field lines always pointing in and out for in the magnetic case, then we end up with the Laplacian of A is minus mu naught J, and this is a Poisson equation. Please remember, for the electric potential we had the Laplacian of V is minus rho over epsilon naught. Some examples. Here are the relations for the general case and for a loop. And now consider a wire. Here it is, and with a magnetic induction field B. Now we have to integrate 1 over R from 0, minus 0 to plus 0, and the integration results in the logarithm of R, and that will lead to infinity, when filling in the limits of integration. And therefore we have to introduce a point of reference. And as the point of reference we use here, R is capital R, as is seen here. We also could have used that point of reference, but that's up to our choice. And we plot, when we plot A as a function of R, then we end up with something like that. Here is R over capital R is 1, the point of reference 0, and here goes the vector potential modulus. Another example is a sheet infinitely long and wide. Here we have the current density in the sheet directed to the x direction, and this will lead to B above in the minus y direction and below the sheet in the plus y direction. It can be found using a rectangle in the yz plane. Rectangle in the yz plane. Then the A field can be found using a rectangle in the xz plane. And above is directed along the current, and below is directed along the current, as is seen here. And the result is, consider C as a constant in amperes per meter, then the J is C times Ex, and B is given by half mu naught C Ey, and then the A is half mu naught C times the modulus of Z times Ex again, and the A values are with respect to the reference at Z is 0. And here we use the Stokes relation of the circulation of A is the surface integral of the rotation of A, and that's the flux. And the Stokes relation was used in a rectangle with sides parallel to the x and z axis. The third example is a solenoid with a current density along the wall, and this will lead to A field circulating around the solenoid, and the A is given by this graph here. And here the reference point is taken at the axis of the solenoid. The toroid. Here is the toroid with the B inside, and the A lines are given as closed circuits along the toroid cross section. Now, the fourth example is a circular circuit with a current I. The B field will be in this direction. Of course, it is cylindrically symmetric, so we only have drawn here one plane of all the planes that are possible. And the A field is given in this direction with this form. And since the A is a vector, you cannot speak about equipotential planes, because you can construct such planes for the modulus, but not for the direction. Equimodulus planes of A have donut shape with the coil as central line, and we will see that in the next screen. The A will be directed tangentially along the donut surface. We have an example, a single coil 20 cm and a current of 1 ampere. And that is seen here, the A field of a single solenoid. This is the y-axis, here is the x-axis, and the x-axis is the symmetry axis. And what is plotted here is the z-component of A. and it is normalized on 100 at this value in newtons per ampere, and that is here seen here. Now, here we have the donut shape with the cross section and in the xy plane of the A donut. This for 20, and here we have 50. And you have to consider this as the cross section of the donut around the line. Here is 100. The vector potential. What are the applications of the vector potential? You can use it for time-dependent fields, and then the following expression holds. Not only the minus gradient of V, but also the time derivative of A. For electromagnetic waves. For dipolar radiation and antenna design. And for light and other waves, scattering and transport, reflection, reflection and so on. And this